like over 10 times you mentioned the word contemplation, and I don't know, I was kind of hoping you would unpack that a little bit, because that's, contemplation is usually thought of as deep and careful thinking, and contemplative stream of Christianity is actually sort of unthinking or listening, or it's passive. And so I was wondering how you meant that word and if you could explain it a little bit.
Sure. I mean, I think some of it is sort of the traditional contemplation of reflection, you know, and of intentional thinking, of, you know, reflecting on our experiences, or as we become more self-aware, reflecting, oh, gee, why did that happen? Or why do I feel that way? But it's funny that you mentioned that, because I get Father Richard Rohr's daily meditations. And the contemplation was the theme for it today. And so, as you said that, I had to open up my email. But what he says, and this is what I would agree, what I meant when I said it. He says, contemplation, my word for this larger seeing, keeps the whole field open. It remains vulnerable before the moment, the event, or the person, before it divides and tries to conquer or control it. Contemplatives refuse to create false dichotomies, dividing the field for the sake of the quick comfort of their ego. And so I think that the act of contemplation for me is an act of trying to integrate the whole self. And I don't do it particularly well. I don't do it on a routine, disciplined basis in the same way that I do my work. But I know when that happens, when I can forgive myself while I, you know, am doing my work, and I'm telling stories, and I'm, you know, working through my shame, and, you know, all of these things that get in the way, that become things that we just have to work harder at, that there is, contemplation for me is that remaining open. And there is even in that phrase, wait on the Lord, there's an evangelical turn of phrase making even that active. Do you know what I mean?
Like wait actively, like stand there waiting.
Just wait. Just, you know, like there's a pride in the waiting, I think. Sometimes. And all I know is that the waiting is terrifying. It's why I don't do it very often. It's why, Lance. You know, you're loved just how you are. You're forgiven. Some of these things I think that we really, really desperately want to hear, but know that we'd fall to bits if we heard them. And I'm not sure I'm willing to relinquish that kind of control.
Because it's a self-medicating, active. I relate to that. And it's only sometimes when you're actually blindsided, or maybe there's an illness, or and you're forced to wait, that some of those gains happen.
I think that my question behind the question is that I think often those moments, sure, they could be spiritual warfare at work. It could be evil trying to attack you and trying to bring you down. But I also think that if that's our posture when bad things happen to us, that we miss out on that it might be, that it could be something more than that. That it could be actually
even
God.
A gift, even.
God, a gift. Saying, I just want you to stop. I just need you to stop right now. I want to talk to you. I want to give you a gift of rest. And when we give it a posture of, this is a little off topic, but it just made me think that maybe that it's in that same sort of vein, and that we're always fighting.
So
I do have to force myself in some ways just to stop. But it's hard. It's very hard for me. Idea that I've had sort of for the last couple of years now is this idea of the artist as the new pastor. When I went to Seattle and I was at my kind of interview thing, I asked, you know, what's the role of the artist here at the school? Because most people were there to become therapists or pastors, and I really didn't have any desire to be either. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I was going sort of non-vocationally. And what one of the professors said at the time is that we really think that the artist is the pastor of the 21st century. And it was just sort of a kind of a thing that they said, and it just captured my imagination of, like, what does that mean? Because it made me think, oh, well, I don't think I can be a pastor, but I know I'm an artist. So does that mean I can also pastor? Mm. And so what I've been working on is this, it would be a book, and it's essentially a manifesto for the artist of faith in the 21st century. Ooh. And that if we look at pastoring as bearing witness, that is sort of what I'm calling artists of faith to do. Ooh. Is to integrate more, to live more at the intersection of the sacred and the secular, to live more of an integrated self between your head and your heart. Ooh. To know your story well, in order to tell a story very well.
Well, you know,
because that's that really is it. I think that we have, you know, we've moved from an agrarian to an industrial to an information to kind of this now inventive age, and I think that the currency is creativity, and creativity to me is not a noun. Right. It's not a thing. It's a way. It's a way of thinking. A way. Right. It's an alternative way of living.
Right.
Which is, I can't think of a more alternative way of thinking than Christianity and living.
Yeah.
And so I think that there's a lot in that. So if you have thoughts of resources that might be helpful, right, as I do my research. But that's kind of the biggest project on the horizon, other than, you know, trying to have a healthy marriage and raise a baby that will end up going to therapy for different reasons than I did.
I already started not the college fund, but the therapy fund for my kids, in a sense. But what you say about storytelling and living in a creative age, I think it's directly tied to community and social. You know, we see social media getting huge, and that's not going anywhere. It's interesting that creatives are positioned really, really nicely to having access to authenticity and truth, and yet having access to community and relationships in the fact that they tell story. Right. And that's what art is. It's some kind of communication of something, hopefully, that's true.
Yep.
Or at least satire or something, but sure, in a sense, true. And so there does seem to be an evolution going on. And I imagine that some of it's because we're going postmodern, and it's not all this, you know, science facts, bullet points stuff.
It apologetic.
Is more, yeah, sure. It's more story, and that's why the idea of narrative theology is so attractive. I think we'll probably have plenty for even maybe two or three videos. But
great.
And
well, I'm so glad. Yeah, absolutely. And thank you so much for the opportunity to share some of the ideas of the book, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I will keep in touch with links and things like that, and then maybe later on, as you come up with some new projects, we could kind of chat about them. And
would love it.
Keep in touch with that.
Cool. Great. Well, Lisa, so good to meet you.
You too, Blaine. Thank you so much.
You bet. Take care.
Have a good day.
You too. Bye.
Bye.